Hi friends, in today's episode of Unplugged, where we deal with integrated picture of disease, today we have selected a disease which has a radiological aspect as well as a pathological aspect. And actually the integrated picture is very interesting, and even for us it is a very interesting thing to discuss, because it has a very interesting element to it that I'll gradually reveal to you in the course of this video. I will start with the history of the patient to give you an overview. You have a 45-year-old woman who has abdominal pain and a lump, and in particular there is a negative history given into you in this question. We are saying there is no pancreatitis, there is no trauma, and a CT abdomen was done. So, if you are a good student, usually when you are looking at a history like this, you can suspect already that the examiner is somehow trying to give you a hint that we are looking at a pancreatic lesion in this question. However, there is no history of pancreatitis or trauma, and the examiner is trying to rule out something. And the age group is very peculiar here. I am already telling you how to look at questions. You are having a very peculiar age group and a female gender in the question. These are all pointing out to something, and a CT scan is done, which is again a hint to you that we are looking at something which is well appreciated on a CT scan. Let's try to see the image. So in front of you, you have a contrast enhanced CT abdomen in front of you. Can you see this is on the left side? Okay, let me point out to you that on the right side, that is the liver, and you can see this is your vertebral column, the kidney, and this is the lesion. A large, maybe with a hint of a few septae, but more or less oligocystic lesion, maybe a thin septa inside. A large cyst in the area of the body and tail, and that is the stomach that you see above it. So we are dealing with the pancreatic cystic lesion, a large cystic lesion with maybe a hint of a septa, but more or less oligocystic or maybe unilocular in appearance in a middle-aged female. That is what we are looking at, and the negative histories that we saw were maybe ruling out pancreatitis. So when I look at it, I am suspecting in a female gender, you always think of cystic pancreatic neoplasms. And the top three things that I have in my mind are, one would be cystic neoplasms can be mucinous, they can be serous, they can be interrupted papillary mucinous neoplasms. However, when I look at the age group and the gender, there is a female predominance in the mucinous cystic neoplasms, which we will explore gradually with the pathology discussion. And even in serous, there is a female predominance. However, when I look at the age, this is not like a grandmother that you are looking at, it's in between. Serous cystic tumor or serous cystadenomas are typically seen in an old lady of the grandmother age, and it has multiple cysts. And the calcification in that is usually center, that is what you call as a sunburst or a stellate calcific scar. And in this patient, we have no calcification evident. You may have calcification even in a mucinous cystic neoplasm, but that is usually peripheral. So by looking at all this, the age group, the female gender, we are probably looking at a mucinous cystic neoplasm. And we have already ruled out, in a way, pancreatitis and all. So we are not looking at pseudocyst at this sort of suspicion. However, we would need a pathological confirmation to find out what we are really looking at. And body and tail is the classic location for a mucinous cystic neoplasm, which again is the approximate location of this lesion in this patient. And what about intraductal papillary mucinous neoplasm, IPMN? Then we would need maybe communication with the pancreatic duct on a radiological image to be demonstrated to call it IPMN. Again, that would be multicystic, typically the pancreatic head, and the male is to female gender ratio is almost equal in IPMN. So I would radiologically put my diagnosis at mucinous cystic neoplasm here. So now I'll hand over to Diksha to help us to find out what exactly is happening here in the pathology.
So in the gross specimen, we can see a cut section of the pancreas, and there's a cyst here which is unilocular, and I hope you can appreciate it's a little shiny. It's probably shiny because when we cut it open, it gave us a lot of tenacious mucin, and that goes in favor of what the radiological appearance was, a unilocular or an oligocystic lesion with a lot of mucin inside. The specimen is not showing any calcification in the periphery, but we can make out it's a single cyst. There's no communication with any duct, even on gross, and once we go to microscopy, which is very interesting, we can see the lining of the cyst, which is mucinous, you know, basal nuclei and mucin. But the interesting thing is actually subepithelial. When you look at the subepithelial region, you can see something that should remind you of your histology from the gonadal histology, that is ovarian stroma, which is now why we get this in this kind of age group and this kind of this sex, female sex. So there is a theory that says that while the gonads are descending, there's an ectopic ovarian stroma somewhere along the pancreas and along the biliary tree, and this is responsive to hormones and it releases hormones. So that causes some proliferation of epithelium with response to hormone activation. These cells, actually what I've put here is normal ovarian stroma, and we can go back and compare it with the cystic stroma. And here, this is ER positive, this is PR positive, which again goes in favor of why we get this in female gender very classically. So
That is, you know, very surprising to see when you're talking about pancreatic lesion and to see the ovarian stroma.
In fact, there's a lesion in the hepatobiliary cyst adenoma also, along with the pancreas, which has ovarian stroma as well, which again goes back to our understanding of during the descent, there is some ectopic mesenchymal tissue, which is now responding to growth factors.
And that probably explains the female predominance in the cystic neoplasms.
Correct, absolutely. So this ovarian stroma is considered to be very diagnostic, and a lot of pathologists do not diagnose it without looking at the ovarian stroma, very classical.
Now, if we divide the pancreatic cystic lesions into neoplastic and non-neoplastic, you know, Diksha, can you help us with the classification?
So, pancreatic cystic lesions are of two types, non-neoplastic and neoplastic, broadly speaking. Your non-neoplastic lesions are pseudocyst, simple cyst, and a retention cyst. But neoplastic requires a little more discussion. Depending on what kind of epithelium you get and what kind of gross appearance, we have mucinous, intraductal papillary mucinous, serocystic, and solid pseudopapillary neoplasm. So mucinous, cystic, intraductal, and serous are usually important to be differentiated for the very simple reason that serous is benign, whereas the other two have a slight malignant potential.
If we look at the morphology of these lesions, you know, you can see for yourself that's a pancreatic pseudocyst, and this is the serous, and you can see the multicystic appearance in a schematic that has been shown to you. In the mucinous cystic neoplasm, you have that oligocystic lesion. And this is the intraductal lesion that you see in IPMN. And in IPN, the tumor is actually intraductal, and what you see as the multicystic lesion is usually the duct ectasia that is happening, the dilatation of the ducts that is happening, giving rise to that typical cystic appearance that you see in IPMN. So that is the reasoning behind. Now, we want to showcase to you a very, very important summary which will do it together for you. Look at the serous neoplasm on the top. Look at the age group and see what I was talking about. 40 to 50 mucinous, 60 to 70 serous. And if you look at the patient that we were discussing, the age was around 45. That is very typical for mucinous. And look at the female predominance in serous and a tremendous female predominance in mucinous, and that was probably explained by the ovarian stroma that we saw.
More than 95% patients female.
Yes. So you can see. So to get an answer is cystic pancreatic neoplasm, the examiner has to mention a female patient in the question. And look at the appearance here. Look at this microcystic appearance that we saw in the schematic and the central scar with calcification in serous. You saw that. And we maybe, you know, Diksha can help us with the...
In the histology, you will see cuboidal cells with clear cytoplasm and very minimal mucin because the lining is different. And the cystic spaces are very small instead of getting a big cystic cavity, which again goes in favor of serous, not mucinous, and no ovarian stroma.
And I would like to mention it here for the radiologists who are listening to us today. Now, please see here, but is this benign and this has a malignant potential? So the thing that I want to make sure that as a radiologist, what we see is, as a radiologist, we are not used to a tumor or a lesion with malignant potential would have more septa, and probably pathologists also look at it in the same manner.
Looks more dangerous.
So actually the serous would look more dangerous, but I want everybody to know that it is the one which is a microcystic appearance, but it is more benign, while the mucinous cystic neoplasms have a malignant potential. So actually one which is looking like a unilocular thing is actually the one which has more malignant potential, and that is where the entire you know, idea of cystic neoplasms that you need to know as a radiologist or a pathologist, or even as a medical graduate, it is very important to know all this. Now, let's look at the imaging in the mucinous neoplasm, macrocystic, peripheral calcification, usually in the body and tail. That is what we saw already. Now, what about the microscopy in mucinous?
Microscopy, again, you'll have columnar epithelium, could be, or different types, could be intestinal, could resemble gastric, could even resemble pre-pyloric epithelium, but it'll always have some mucin, and like I said, most importantly, ovarian stroma diagnostic. And one interesting point I wanted to point out, the cystic fluid that you will get in the mucinous cyst will have elevated levels of CEA. And we've also seen KRAS mutations in these, which could be explanation for why this has a very important malignant potential, KRAS being one of the most important genes involved in pancreatic cancer.
And finally, you know, we would like to look at the intraductal papillary mucinous neoplasms. In that, you know, the key thing that I want you to look at, that male is female equal. So look at the female predominance in the serous and the mucinous, while when we go towards IPMN, the male is to female ratio is almost equal. And this is what I was already talking about, the dilated pancreatic duct, bunch of Graves connected to them. And so the communication with pancreatic duct is the key radiological feature for IPMN. So, and that mucus production is
again
the
not very classical, but the since it's an intraductal papillary tumor, there's some architectural complexity as compared to the other tumors. The other two usually will have a single lining or at the most a little more, but here you get nice papillae, which is why we are calling it a papillary neoplasm, and no ovarian stroma, and of course mucin will be present. The tumor cells themselves will look a little more dysplastic and dangerous as compared to the lining of the other two.
And again, the malignant potential would be there.
Definitely.
So it is important to remember, serous are the one which you can, as a radiologist, say that, okay, you know, this is going to have a good prognosis. Serous cystinoma typically would be a grandmother aged female with a multicystic lesion with a central stellate scar, which you can see on a radiological image. It would look a little aggressive to you as compared to the mucinous, but you know that, okay, once you know it, you know that this is the one which has a more benign course. So that is the learning that we wanted you to develop through this unplugged video. And it is our earnest request that you please follow us on DAMCD channel on YouTube and DAMCD page on Facebook for more such videos. And do scroll back at the playlist for many videos that we have created in the past. And to the best of our knowledge and ability to, you know, find out things, we've seen that throughout the internet, there are very few videos where multiple specialties, people are looking at things together. It is always like one person or one field doing it together. And so we have, you know, done our best to do a more integrated picture. Like yesterday, we did a maple syrup urine disease. Many of you must have seen this video. We have done a lot of emergencies and a lot of other things in the past. We have looked at many brain tumors and even pancreatic tumors. We've done a lot of videos in the past. So I would recommend that, you know, if you're a medical graduate anywhere in the world, please look at those videos. Do write back to us in the comment section if you enjoy it. If you want us to do any specific lesion that you feel is interesting. Because reason that we selected this topic today was it has a very interesting twist to it.
Right.
And the twist is
the ovarian stroma.
Because it's so interesting to know that how heterogeneous our, you know, body and the diseases are, you know, and that is where you have to, in all humility, accept that, okay, medical science is all about continuum learning in life. So you gradually you realize that, you know, okay, you can even find ovarian stroma in a pancreatic lesion, and there are people who would not call a lesion mucinous cystic neoplasm till the time they demonstrate
ovarian stroma
on pathological slide. So that is the kind of learning that we want everybody to develop, and that is what the kind of curiosity that we want you to develop. Do write back to us in the comment section for anything that you want to us to add and improve. We are very happy to hear from you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Please do follow us on the YouTube channel. Thank you very much.